How do you do, fellow kids? I've emerged from my cave of shadows, having watched across the Spiderverse 3 times, and now, like a salmon feeling the call of migration to its inevitable doom, I am compelled to make a video essay. Today I'll be discussing the villains from across the Spiderverse, so obviously, super spoilers. You've been warned. Okay, are they gone? Cool. So for a villain to be perfect, they need to perfectly serve what the movie's about. And movies can be about a lot of things. On one level, the Spider-Verse is kind of just about cool animation, and all of these three core antagonists are visually very fun to watch. But for our purposes, I'm focusing on narrative. And the narrative is about Miles and his coming of age. The first Spider-Verse movie was a very traditional coming-of-age story. You know, your classic Spider-Boy becomes Spider-Man. And now in the sequel, he's a Spider-Man with adult decisions to make. For a lot of young adults, opening one door means closing another. For Miles, that means choosing to be a hero, but then it hurts his academic prospects. It means going to college in New Jersey, but then seeing his parents less. And it appears now he'll have to choose between being Spider-Man and keeping his dad alive. This angst of wanting to have everything against the constraints that life puts on us is something that we all experience. It's what makes Miles relatable, and it's the core of his emotional struggle. I really like this arc for Spider-Verse because what Miles feels growing up and discovering mandatory sacrifices is mirrored by his journey into the Spider-Verse, where he finds this seemingly infinite range of Spider-Men that all still have constraints on what they can have. They all need to lose an Uncle Ben, and they all need to lose a police chief. So for these villains to be narratively perfect, they need to complement and expand upon the ideas of choice and wide yet tragically finite potential. We'll start with the Spot, who shares a common origin with Miles and blames him for ruining his life, when really it was his own shitty choices that were to blame. The Spot refuses to acknowledge he had any control over his life, which is a good contrast to Miles, who has a very firm belief in his own agency. But the primary role of the Spot is to represent the impending doom of choices being imposed on Miles. On a high level, it's the Spot's fault that Miles sees the rest of the Spider-Verse and finds out that his father is destined to be killed. And down at a ground level, it's literally the Spot who's trying to kill his dad because he's Spider-Man. Next, we have Miles from Earth 42. Record scratch, hopefully I'll be able to find the sound effect. Okay, so I know he's barely in this one, but cut me a little bit of slack. He really rounds out the trio. So well. Prowler Miles represents the fact that with different circumstances and less privileges, Miles could have gone down a very different path. The horror for our Miles is that the only difference between him and his evil twin is one spider. Or I guess, like, if you do the math, maybe 2 spiders. I know it's the same spider, but like Miles 42 lost one and then Spider Miles gained one. But regardless of the math, he forces Miles to confront how close he really was to a radically different life, and that he is a product of factors not entirely under his control. It's possible that if that spider hadn't switched realities, maybe Earth 42 Miles would have been Spider-Man and our Miles the Prowler. Actually, that's probably what would have happened, because in the Spot sequence, we see the spider was right behind Miles 42 when it got teleported. So it's actually very likely that this spider targeted our Miles because it was supposed to bite his parallel version. Finally, we have the piece de resistance. Those other two, they're great. I really love what they do, and they don't take up too much screen time. But if this is Charles Dickens, and Miles 42 and the Spot are the ghosts of Christmas past and present, then Miguel is the ghost of Christmas future. And we all know that it was Christmas future that actually kicked Scrooge into shape.
The check's been out with me. Is this straight? May I? Did our people do that?
So pretty immediately with Miguel, the audience is invited to compare him to Miles, because often they're opposites in a way that demands comparison. Miles wasn't meant to be Spider-Man, but fits in very naturally with the other spiders. And Miguel was meant to be Spider-Man, but his lack of humor and his vampire stuff really means that he sticks out like a sore thumb. Also, Miles is really lean, and Miguel is built like a very edgy brick house. I really like how they kind of play his triangular body off for horror. Also, Miles is young and grappling with his vast potential, while Miguel is middle-aged and haunted by his past and what could have been. They even beg comparison on an aesthetic level. You see, the spider people each have an associated instrument in the score. Gwen has the drums, Hopi has guitar, Pav has... Damaru? These are all very distinct, but Miles and Miguel both have digital horns, except Miguel's sounds distorted and kind of lonely. So when we see Miguel, it's kind of like we're hearing the dark future of Miles. Also, they both speak Spanish, and if you look really closely at Miguel's name, you'll find that actually, it can be rearranged into Miolug, which isn't Miles, but it's still a little bit weird that it got that close. In a way, they're both anomalies, which makes it clear that Miguel is projecting every time he snarls and calls Miles an anomaly. Miguel tried what Miles is trying. He tried to have it all, and instead lost everything. And now he sees Miles full of hope, and he resents it. Miguel represents hopelessness and resignation as he can't accept that things could go well for Miles, because to do so would mean that there was hope for him, destroying the fatalism that Miguel uses as a coping mechanism for the trauma of losing his family. Across the Spider-Verse is a film about Miles and his struggle for self-determination, and his three villains perfectly frame the ways that we all grapple with choice in our lives. The stress of current choices, the lack of any real control, and the dread for where they could lead us. With so many multiverse movies coming out right now, it's really awesome to see films like Across the Spider-Verse actually crafting stories about the human experience, instead of just an excuse to go, "Wow, what if the thing we know, but another actor and change slightly?" It's a really good movie. I'll probably do another video on it, so consider subscribing if you want to see that. And until next time, stay bumpin'.